Hi, everyone. This is Trey Parker's voice.
And this is Matt Stone's voice.
And this is us doing commentary. This is our voices doing commentary.
We haven't done a lot of commentary. We're going to try to do more than a commentary mini on this. We've been doing that for a long time.
Always do commentary, and then we end up saying things that are illegal and really offensive, and they cut it out. So it always ends up being 5 minutes long anyway. So then we decided, well, let's just do 5 minutes worth of stuff, because then, you know, odds are we'll just talk about the show and we won't start saying horrible things about people. But this time we came up with an idea where we're letting them, whoever's doing the DVD, if they need to edit something that we've said, then you're just going to hear this. So if you hear that music, it means that we were saying something illegal and
illegal, or something that would get Comedy Central sued,
in trouble. Yeah,
so right. They have a legal department that listens to this and makes sure we don't say anything that'll get them sued.
So anyway, we're into Imaginationland. This is an idea we had for a long time. The idea about terrorists attacking our imagination we had for a long time, and we'd been wanting to do, and it was kind of one of those ideas that we kept talking to. You know, in sort of the middle of the run, we'd be like, oh, let's do that Imaginationland idea now. And then the animators would be like, dude, there's no way. We can't, you know, it was just too big of an idea to kind of pull off in the middle of a run. But actually, right now, we should talk a little about Tom Cruise and Scientology. Raping babies. And now back to Imaginationland. I just wanted to see if the music thing would work.
Yeah.
I have no idea now.
I think they probably didn't hear anything but music.
They covered that. I hope
considering what you said about Tom Cruise. So anyway, Imaginationland, it is an idea we had for a while. And when we got into making it, it was, I don't know, we kind of decided to really... And kind of the reason it became a multi-parter was we kind of decided to use that form of a kid going to Imaginationland, of kind of like the Narnia movies, and like, of course, the big one being Harry Potter, where a kid gets taken from his shitty normal life and taken to this wonderful world where they are a prince or a king or special or...
And that's the kid kind of is the almost formula. Always like an orphan or something.
An orphan, you know, they have really mean parents. I mean, it's a pretty classic thing. So, I mean, we decided that could give us kind of a form for you know, the Imaginationland part of it. But it really didn't start to really take off until we kind of coupled it with Kyle having to suck Carmen's balls.
Yeah.
When the whole thing really started.
We had the whole theme of, let's do terrorists attacking our imagination because of the double entendre of that, you know, whole thing. And so we had that for a long time. But then finally we came up with this idea of how we would get into the show. And we just kind of threw out, and then Cartman can, you know, bet him that he saw the leprechaun. And then all of a sudden we had the ball sucking thing. And then we were like, okay, well, now we have a trilogy. Now we have a trilogy for sure.
And actually, we did entertain for a few weeks when we were working on this last summer, making this another South Park movie.
Yeah.
Because it felt like, well, this is maybe a big enough idea. It could hold, you know, it could hold all these ideas as a big enough theme.
Not the ball sucking part, but the actual part of it.
Yeah, the actual smart part of it could. But I think I think we made the right decision. It felt like, I don't know, it felt more like, I don't know, it kind of just felt like a trilogy. It kind of felt like a TV show.
Yeah, as we
show.
Got, well, and as we got into it too, it was
didn't
funny because
like
lately, you know, we've been, I think that a lot of the best writing that's coming out of Hollywood right now is TV drama stuff. I mean, I think some of the best writing is in shows like Battlestar Galactica and 24 and shows that are, it's sort of the new serial, you know, format. And so I just wanted to do something because it was something to try where you had to, you know, pick up where you left off last week and keep going with it. And we literally did that. I mean, we had some broad strokes. I mean, I think we always knew that Kyle was going to suck Cartman's imaginary balls at the end.
Right,
like,
we knew that was going to happen. We had our end figured out really early on.
And we knew that there would be a nuke in the government somehow. We kind of had that idea. But other than that, we literally made the first episode and it went on the air And it aired on Wednesday as usual, and everyone was like, wow, I can't wait to see what happens next week. And we're like, yeah, us too, because we had no idea.
Right, and we'd spend a lot more time making the first episode than a week, and so we were a little worried about the second and third episodes.
Yeah, we actually, with this episode, we actually came back and, like, we did something we hardly ever do, which is we came in and we kind of worked on stuff even though we didn't have a show airing that week. We came in and worked on stuff in the summer.
We worked in our summer. It was like going to summer school.
It really, it sucked. It's like, and it's pretty funny, too, because a lot of the stuff we worked on, you know, we learned, for one thing, we learned why we shouldn't do that and why we don't do that, because basically we came here, and even though we came up with some good stuff, we just spun our wheels, and then it went from basically what it ended up being. It started off that way. And then all of a sudden we started going, oh, no, wait, okay, I know. The Imagination Land is one idea, and then we'll do the Cartman ball sucking as another story. And we tore the two shows apart, started to make them two different shows, and then all of a sudden we're like, okay, the Imagination Land is just one episode, and it was just sort of an
exercise. And then for a while
we
had a leprechaun chase in the beginning, and we thought there would be a whole nother episode just about leprechauns.
Yeah, because we love the leprechaun chase, and we already had that animated. And we're like, oh, but that scene's so good, so maybe we'll just keep the leprechaun in. And then we'll keep it for the Halloween special, and it can be a leprechaun that gets bitten by a werewolf and becomes a werepercon.
Yeah, and then gets bitten by a vampire.
See, this is what happens when we don't have a show airing that week.
And it becomes a werepercon pyre. And then
it gets killed by a zombie.
And then
but then it comes back to life, so then it's a zombie werepercon pyre. And then it turns out it's actually an alien.
An alien, yeah. We actually had that idea for an episode. You might see it next Halloween.
Yeah, actually. As soon as we start running out of ideas, you'll be seeing the zombie werepercon pyre for sure.
Let's go to back to Imagination Land. This scene here where the boys get taken to Imagination Land, this was why we kind of went back and forth on the leprechaun thing, because we really did think for a while that to do the Imagination Land justice, to get into it and have it be funny in that kind of Harry Potter, Narnia kind of way, that the show shouldn't start with a leprechaun. It should start with, like, the power goes out, or the parents saying, right, like, you know, why don't you guys go outside and use your imagination? So you have that classic thing where the kids are outside going,
having to use their imagination. Yeah. What are we going to do? How do we do that?
And then he shows up. And it felt like, well, we needed that kind of pure open. So for a lot of time, for a while, this scene was like the second scene of the show. The first one being where the kids are kicked outside and told they can't. Use their imaginations.
Then we spent a lot of time trying to figure out how we could go from this to the ball sucking thing. Like, then they were going to see.
And then they were going to bet about when they see a leprechaun in Imagination Land.
But anyway, I'm
glad it ended up the way it did. But it did take a long time to figure out how to get into this, because there was going to be a theme, and we ended up bailing on it. In the beginning, there was going to be that theme of, like, why don't you go use your imagination? Like, this kind of thing, like, kids don't use their imaginations anymore. They're kind of too busy texting and playing Xbox and shit. And then we were going to show how bad their imaginations really are.
Yeah.
And maybe they shouldn't use their imagination.
There was a whole lot of different ideas with Imagination Land. And then I remember that we just sort of held on to it, because we're like, well, we don't know what to do. Let's just hold on to it, and we'll do the run of South Park without using this. Right. That's, first of all, that's never going to happen. So it was like the idea that we're going to somewhere be in the middle of a run of South Park and have a show that's kind of done and not use it. But we thought, okay, well, let's just hang on to it and we'll figure out what to do with it. And then by the third week, we were like, okay, we're out of ideas. We got to use this Imagination Land idea. And I remember we actually spent about an hour where we were going to just make it one episode. This entire thing was going to happen in one episode, which would have been insane.
Without the ball sucking, though.
And now, looking at it now, the idea that this would have all been in one episode was ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's just, there's just too much going on. And it went from, like, oh, let's make it a two-parter to let's make it a seven-parter.
We talked about making it a five-parter, because we'd done two episodes before this, which is, you know, the funny thing is the first episode of this run was a Tourette syndrome, where Cartman pretends he has Tourette's. And then the second one was this brilliant episode called More Crap, where Randy takes the world's biggest crap, and then you find out Bono is actually a piece of crap.
And so there was a lot of hidden meanings behind that show that people didn't get.
And so they're pretty, like, scat heavy South Parks. And then then it was like, we thought it was so funny that we did one of those that it was like, I love that show, More Crap, but I just, you know, that, like, you know, sometimes we have these like live in two worlds where, like, we get to do total shit jokes, and then every once in a while we'll do, like, something that's considered quote unquote smart, and then we win awards for it. And so then, like, we just put just more crap. And then the next episode we did Imaginationland, which we knew we had worked on a long time. And
we knew it had at least a smart
a lot of and it had a lot of production value. It looked like it was much bigger. The collegiate crowd and the college educated crowd would be like, that's interesting.
So now we're in the area of the big scene. This is, again, this is something we had pretty early on, because we always knew that the big gist of it all is that terrorists have attacked our imagination. And so we're like, well, let's actually have the terrorists attack our imagination, and what would that look like? And so obviously we went right to Saving Private Ryan for part of that. And, you know, the thing about Tom Hanks is, anyway, that's all I have to say about that. But, so we, you know, when you get into a show like this, unlike having to do the giant crab-taking show.
By the way, this is what dates us, is we have phones like this in our show.
Yeah, I know.
We think of phones still that look like this because we're old guys. And then later on, in like part two or three, the Cartman's at a payphone.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, people have fucking wireless phones and they talk on cell phones.
We still write stuff with payphones. That's cool. It's got to be. There's probably one payphone in all of DC now. But, you know, this is these shows are obviously hard when you're doing something this huge that's sort of a, not only are you kind of trying to say something, but you're also got just, you know, obviously a lot of big shit going down. And so it just becomes sort of a structural nightmare. But in a way, it was kind of nice to just be able to say, well, we'll just throw up all these balls in the air and then we'll deal it, and then we'll see what happens.
And then we'll deal with it next week.
Yeah.
Endings always kind of suck. And the fact that we had the ending that we wanted to do with the imaginary balls and Kyle's imaginary mouth, that was so, we knew that, like, we actually had the last 3 minutes or 4 minutes of the entire trilogy figured out way ahead of time. And that was kind of weirdly soothing. But then, but it was kind of nice, like, as Trey said, the first week, yeah, you could just not solve anything. And then the second episode, we didn't have to solve anything. You just keep the balls up in the air.
Right.
Which is fun.
Which is fun because it was, you know, tonight as trying to learn and become better writers, we doing exercises like this where it's a whole new experience and a whole new way to write where, you know, it was really studying some of the 24 stuff and the Battlestar Galactic stuff and sort of how do they do that? How do they make you want to, you know, tune in the next week? And we realized that it really has changed. You know, it used to be in all these serials that you used to have before movies and stuff. I'm talking way back, you know, in the black and white days and stuff. They would do those serials and they would always, the cliffhanger was always, you know, the hero went off a cliff or the hero is drowning or the hero's on fire and, you know, will he live? And that was basically always the cliffhanger. And nowadays we really, it always changed. You know, it's never, very rarely is it Jack Bauer is, you know, he's in peril. He's shot. Is he dead? I don't know. You know, it's like it happens, but it's very rare. More often it's that at the very end, he gets back up again and he's really pissed and he's heading off after him, you know, and it's like he's up and going again. And that's sort of, that's the new cliffhanger. It's like, oh, he's back up, here he goes, you know, and there's just a lot more sort of movement to that. I think it's probably a lot of it's because people got fooled enough by saying, I know the guy's not going to burn to death and fall off the cliff. And
yeah.
So.
Yeah, I've seen too many Batmans where they live on the other side. That doesn't make sense.
So anymore. It was sort of the thing we realized, you know, it's all about, if we wanted to take that structure and then just put it to ball sucking. So it was really like, you know, how do you take these ball sucking beats and put them in 24? It's all about, you know, you've almost got your thing. You've almost found the nuclear device. You've almost got it, but then it's taken away from you, you know. And then, you know, we knew that in Act 2 somewhere there would be a point where he's right there with it, but then the next thing, you know, he just loses opportunity. And then, you know, sort of applying those ups and downs to ball sucking was sort of how we structured this entire thing.
Yeah, so it starts with him going and asking, no. Then he goes to court. Then he gets a court order.
Right.
And then Kyle comes over to the house, and then he gets taken. So the end of episode one is he gets taken.
Right.
By the government.
And then, that's why the beats couldn't just be, he's after Kyle. He's trying to get Kyle to suck his ball. He's after Kyle. He's after Kyle. He's after Kyle. We realize, well, even in Act 2, he's got to get to a point where he's got Kyle. And just like in 24, you're going to end up in a room where
Jack Bauer
your
has
two
the
guys,
guy.
Yeah, yep. And they're in that room. They're in that interrogation room. And you're like, oh, well, here we go. What's going to, and then something happens so that that, you know.
And well, that's something that happens is that Cartman has to put on a little suit and take a picture of it. He just can't.
Yeah. If he could have just, Kyle was fully ready to suck his balls at that moment in the
and
show.
And then so in episode two, to escalate it, we had to go all the way till Kyle's dead.
Yeah.
But then he's back, like the end of 24.
So now we're in the area of the famous director scene. This was something we talked about a long time because we just love the idea. You know, obviously there's always this talk when terrorist things happen that the government goes to Hollywood because they're so creative.
I think they actually did after 9/11.
Yeah, no, there was an actual thing. And, you know, I mean, personally, I'm a big Sixth Sense fan. I think that was a great movie, and I was fooled by it. I got duped. You know, I was like, I didn't see it coming, and a lot of people tell me I'm stupid for not seeing it coming, the ending. But, and so, you know, I got suckered into all the other crap, Unbreakable and Signs and all, just these dog shit movies that was basically the exact same thing. It's just like, surprise at the end, and you're like, what? That's it, you know? And so,
I got fooled by Sixth Sense too. It totally hit
me. And it's really not weird. I mean, it's weird. It makes it because he had just tons of time and tons of, you know, he just sat and thought about that movie and thought about it. And he's making that movie at a time in his career when everyone's not telling him he's a genius.
Yes, he doesn't have the George Lucas syndrome yet.
And unfortunately, what happens is you make something like Sixth Sense, and then everyone tells you you're a genius and you're flawless, and then you start doing Unbreakable and Signs and all these other things, and you think that they're perfect and flawless, and what you really need is a producer to tell you, this isn't very interesting, and you need to spice this up here, and, you know, all that crap.
Yeah, I read this thing about M. Night Shyamalan and Ding Dong and how you have to go to his office to read the script for, like, Signs or for anything.
Yeah, well, because so, if the ending gets out,
the whole thing's ruined.
Yeah.
But it's just like, man, just fucking send your shit out so people can make it better. It's seriously. Like, if it's a good movie, it you should... I mean, Sixth Sense, I actually think you could watch... I don't know about this. I've never watched it again.
No, I did. You can.
I think you could watch it again.
The guy has skill. The guy's got
good.
Skills.
I think that's a well-directed
movie.
He's got
skills as a director. It's just that... Now he writes his script and then he shoots it and he thinks it's perfect and he puts it out and it's dog shit.
Now he takes his shit and he puts it out.
Whereas Mel Gibson, on the other hand, we've had a change of heart on Mel Gibson because when the whole you know, his whole Jesus movie came out and everything, when we did an episode about that, actually.
And the Jesus movie isn't good.
No,
it's not cheesy and stupid.
But the you know, we did a show about that and we just made him into a loon because basically that's what he seemed like, was just a loon, and everyone's like, okay, well, you just hate Mel Gibson. And but then, you know, when there was always this thing in the back, it was like, yeah, but, you know, I could never argue, like, even Braveheart, for instance, which is not a great piece of cinema, but it's solid,
it's
structurally solid, it's well done, it's well directed, you can't really argue it. And so then he came out with Apocalypto. And I sat and watched it on TV. And I was like, God damn it, this guy knows
Struggle.
It's not, again, not a fantastic movie, but way better than anything M. Night Shyamalan Ding Dong has done, you know, since Sixth Sense. But, you know, it's structurally, the guy knows how to make movies. And he's insane, and that's why it's interesting to
Excellent.
Watch his movies.
When he yelled at the cops in Malibu, that was probably one of the better days of my life. It just confirmed. It was like everyone was on. You know, there was this huge argument whether he was an anti-Semite or not, and people really staked their territory. I mean, you had to kind of take a side.
Yeah.
You know, and it was like, no, he's not. I know. And then he just fucking went and yelled Jew and shit. Yeah. Just like crazy about it that night. That was the best thing.
So it really ended up in the show like basically exactly how we feel. Like we still think he's totally crazy and out of his mind.
But he's talented.
But son of a bitch knows structure.
Since he's gotten totally insane, he's now one of my favorite directors.
Yeah.
I'm more interested, like, the next Mel Gibson movie that comes out, I will definitely go see.
Right.
Like, Apocalypto, I was like, I'm seeing that movie. I saw it on the first day in the movie theater. I don't get to see shit. I never see movies. I was on the first day in the movie theater, and I will be there for his next movie. First day. Mel Gibson, I love you. We should have got him to do his own voice. I wonder if he would.
I doubt it. He's way too big time for us.
Fuck you guys. I'm not doing that. So here, of course, this is the first time you see Cartman dressed up because he needs to be wearing either a king or a pope or a sultan costume to get his balls sucked. Of course.
Yeah, we had stuff like this in, and some of these lines got cut out that are now back in this DVD version. But You know, there was always, especially from the sort of the younger audience, the kids were just like, I don't get why Cartman wants Kyle to suck his balls so much. I mean, why is he gay all of a sudden? And I guess that's because when you're a kid, you haven't gotten to that level of maturity where you understand that. Yeah.
That level of immaturity where you are totally immature about sucking balls.
I mean, it has nothing to do with anything sexual, that it's just the ultimate way that Cartman can humiliate Kyle, ultimate and that's what this is all about.
That level of maturity. So as you can see here, this exact scene has happened in 24, minus balls.
Yeah, you're so close to the balls, but then the government comes and takes the balls away from you. That's happened in 24, 800 times. Yeah. Jack Bauer just about has the balls in his mouth, and then all of a sudden the government comes and rips the balls away.
You can taste them, and they're just right there.
Jack Bauer could almost taste those balls.
This is another thing we changed for the DVD. What happened on this first episode was that it was late on the Tuesday that we were doing it, and what was supposed to happen was that in the first episode, all the evil stuff from behind the wall was going to bust out and start raising hell in the good part of Imaginationland, and then you would cut on Butters and people running away. But it got to be about 4 o'clock in the morning. We had about 3 or 4 hours left to.
Yeah, the show had to totally be done.
It had to be done by, 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning. It's 4 o'clock in the morning, and we still have storyboards in this part, and it's not going to get done. Yeah.
So we had all that stuff where, Alien and Predator came out.
Oh, that was going to happen in the first episode, yeah. So then we basically had to recut it at 4 o'clock in the morning.
At 4 o'clock in the morning, we had to rewrite it. We had to go in and just do this whole thing and said, okay, we'll make this whole, he'll do this little speech, and it'll just be this kind of, diversion, and then the wall will just start coming down, and then that'll be
what
the cliffhanger. And at the time, we were really bummed out. We thought, we always do this to ourselves, where it's, early morning Wednesday, the show's going on that night. We've been here for 20 more, hours working on the show, and we just thought, oh my God, okay, well, we worked so hard on this thing, and now it's ruined. We just thought it was the most horrible. Everyone was going to be so unsatisfied with that ending, but it actually turned out to be okay. People were kind of like, what's behind the wall? What's behind the wall? Which, again, we were like, we have no fucking idea.
We didn't know it. We didn't really know at the time.
Except for Alien and Predator, we knew that.
We didn't really know what was going to be specifically behind the wall. But then another thing that happened is that in our late night confusion, our confused late night minds, we had the terrorists put Rockety Rocket into the wall but not die. So we had to have them die in episode 2, which was totally stupid.
Oh, yeah.
So in this version, now they die like suicide bombers.
Yeah, because it was a shitty shot where they had to just get killed by a monster anyway. Because it was just something. We did that. Yeah, I remember.
So dumb. Like the next day, we're like,
why didn't they just die in the wall? Like now we got to deal with them.
Now we got to figure out what the terrorists are doing.
Yeah, that was dumb. Now we're into episode 2. And it was really, coming to work on Thursday morning, and first of all, it was night because we saw, we got feedback from, and a lot of the times our feedback is just our friends, we always know when we had a good show because I'll hear from my dad and, various friends will just email and go, that was sweet, or that was better than a giant shit last week.
That was a 6.5 out of 10.
But so we came in that morning, we're in the writer's room, we're like, okay. So what happens now? And, again, we had some idea. We kind of had the whole Stargate thing, definitely not figured out, but we thought we knew that part of the story would be nuking the government wanting to nuke the imagination.
Right.
Like that just seemed like a smart way to go. And so then we knew we needed some kind of doorway into it for the government to be able to do that. And that's when we started talking about
the Stargate. Yeah, I mean, it's always like, because we had this idea for a while, so. It's always fun to sit there and talk about, terrorists strike the imagination. You start thinking of all the double meanings you can come up with and all the lines, and our imaginations are running wild. We have to get our imaginations under control and all the theoretical and abstract stuff and how great it's going to be. And then when you actually have to start making the episode, you realize that you have to figure out the logic of, and we want them to nuke our imagination. Okay, how's the nuke get there? Because you got to figure out, the boys got there through this song. But then they got back, it became kind of this confusing thing. And for instance, one thing we argued about for a long time that we just kind of left out, and if you want to split hairs. How do the terrorists get into Imaginationland?
Hey, hey, whoa, whoa, whoa.
How does that happen, huh?
Actually, I know how.
Did they build...
Because they're what? The Chinese do have a doorway into imagination.
Yeah, that's right. We had a whole story. We had a whole storyline where the Russians had a bunch of imagination doorways.
From the Cold War.
From the Cold War, and the terrorists got a hold of one, and then they used it to bomb our imagination, and we were going to have that as a storyline, and we got rid of it.
Because that's plotty. Too thinky.
That's
and we just wanted to get back to ball sucking.
Too thinky. So we basically... copied Stargate, and I don't know why, but I like Stargate, that dumb movie.
Again, solid. It's solid. It's not a good movie, but it's well done. And especially nowadays, just a movie that's well done, that's, you know, got good structure.
It doesn't totally fucking suck.
Has some kind of a point to it, is pretty tough.
I have a kind of guilty pleasure is the guys who did Independence Day and Stargate are kind of guilty pleasures of mine. Because I know they're fucking cheesy, stupid movies. I kind of can't turn them off when they come on. So Stargate,
I'm like that with Devil's Advocate, except it's not a shitty movie. It's fucking awesome.
I'm like that with other movies too, but like those movies I know are bad.
I'm like that with anything with Al Pacino. I just can't turn it off. And I hate all actors except for Al Pacino, so that's pretty tough.
This dream sequence is from that movie, Gladiator.
Kind of, just the thing with the wheat.
Kind of Gladiator, but then it was like, what was that movie that came out last? Oh, 300 had a bunch of this shit in it.
But I don't think anyone's balls exploded.
No, they didn't. Guy hated that movie too, 300.
It was definitely the, with the balls, you know, it was again in part two trying to figure out, all right, trying to figure out a structure. Because, you know, in our show, because for some reason, you know, we've just chosen to do a show like this and now this is how we have to do it. We have to actually have a story through line from the beginning to the end that makes sense, and we can't just go from one thing to another, so we had to actually figure out the structure of this whole middle show. And so we're like, man, there's so much going on. We got Terrace, we got Imagination Doorway, we've got our imaginations, we've got the, you know, the government side plot, and then we've got all this ball sucking, and what do we do? And I did my usual thing of wanting to kill myself on Thursday, but then we kind of took a deep breath and said, all right, let's just beat out the ball sucking story. And again, going back to 24, it was, you know, taking that dramatic stuff of like, okay, well, we don't want Cartman just chasing Kyle, so he should get to Kyle fairly early on. He should get to Kyle, should be there in a room together, and then you got to do that thing that you do in 24 where it's like, not just 24, but a lot of the great TV drama. I think all the writing in TV dramas is better than most of the movie writing going on now. And it's like, okay, so what's the opposite of getting someone to suck your, making someone suck your balls, saving their life? So now Cartman needs to save Kyle's life. So then we knew, all right, so somehow Cartman has to save Kyle's life.
They do it all the time in 24 where Bauer has to save the bad guy.
Right.
Because the bad guy has the key of the nuke that he set, the fucking worst guy in the world.
Yeah.
They do all that all the time.
We were pretty happy when we figured out the part that the boys, that the imagination song was going to actually have a point.
Yeah, because that was just a joke. That was just a throwaway joke in the first one. And then, well, because also we were trying to figure out, yeah, why does the government need these boys? Because we knew we wanted them there with the government and a nuke, but we didn't know why they would have to be there.
Right. They know that they know from the video they're friends with Butters, because Butters said, Stan and Kyle, get me out of here. But then,
why would they need them? The song.
How can the boys be active? Because that was really it. We knew why they were there. The government saw the video and heard about these guys, Stan and Kyle. But then, that's a big challenge, you know, when you're writing a show too, is basically, and especially in South Park, it's hard a lot because we've got little kids. And so a lot of times, you know, a scene isn't going to work so well when you just got kids standing there while all this stuff's going on around them. And for a long time, we just had these Stargate scenes and everything's being explained to them, but there was nothing for them to do. We're like, well, what are the kids going to do here? And then we figured out, oh, they have to somehow be the key to get the thing to work. And then we figured out that's the song. And this all happens on like a Friday or something.
And then we feel really smart that we figured out what it should have been from the start.
Yeah.
It was also a big breakthrough when we figured out that Snarf would be one of the characters that goes along with Butters.
Yeah.
Because he's so fucking annoying and it just seems so like stupid.
That was one of the things that so many of my friends anyway were like, hey man, so cool you finally did that Snarf thing, man. I fucking hated that Snarf guy too. You know, it was like kind of, it touched that. I mean, a lot of people that were sort of our generation that remember, because I liked Thundercats and so did a lot of my friends. I remember being a kid, we all watched Thundercats, but fucking Snarf would ruin it all the time. You're having a great time watching Thundercats, and you know, even when you're like 8 years old, you're like, not fucking Snarf. And so it was nice to finally put him in this.
Another great thing about this episode is we got to bring back the Christmas critters. because that was another big breakthrough, because that episode is one of our favorite, the Christmas Critter episode, and those characters are great, but technically they're in Cartman's imagination because he just read the story.
So we wanted to do more with them, but then we realized, well, they're not real. They're in Cartman's imagination.
Yeah, but they don't exist. So this was a great way to bring them back. And it also made sense because, you know, then Stan knows about who they are.
There was a lot of things that the critter said in this episode that got cut.
Yeah, standards and practices let us do some shit. So
and it's pretty funny because looking back, we're like, okay, well, let's put some of what they said back in this version. And then we played it back and we're like, oh, dude, no, let's not put that in there. That's fucking weak.
You can't just kill everyone. It was like, first you got to rape their children.
In front of them.
In front of them, and then, then kill them. And then standards wouldn't let us say that. So then it was, well, we could rape the parents in front of the children and then kill the children. They said no.
No. So then it became about AIDS. Peeing AIDS into their eye. And they're like, okay, that's fine. Yeah.
Somehow that was all right. And then we had to look up if you could even get AIDS from pee. We'd never really found out. Did we find out?
No, you can only get it from toilet seats.
Don't share a drink with anybody who has AIDS.
And sharing drinks.
Don't do that.
Sharing
sure.
sodas.
But you can swallow the pee and it's fine.
This took us a while, remember, to do the song right?
Yeah.
Like, we had to actually go back and listen to
episode one and do it right.
Probably wouldn't have even mattered, but.
And then coming up here, they make the opening. The next scene with the Stargate is where we just ripped it off shot for shot from Stargate.
Yeah.
With Kurt Russell. And in fact, ripped off Kurt Russell and just put him in there. So it was obvious that we knew. Wanted people to know, we know we're ripping this off. Again, shot for shot.
And that's what we think about Kurt Russell, basically. We had all these parts of Imaginationland that we hadn't, you know, we had these ideas of like, oh, there's going to be storybook land, and then they'll go, you know, really, it could have been this big, epic movie. I mean, it could have been a lot longer than it was, but it probably would have gotten really annoying, too.
Well, there wasn't a real reason. It was just going to be like, just going to become a stupid, like, you know, going from place to place, and it wasn't going to, you know. This part's funny.
Yeah, this is.
That's the eyeball. They're going to pee in that eyeball.
This is the director's version. There's a lot of things here and there, and this is definitely one thing that we had to cut down for the airing. They wouldn't let the eyeball thing be quite so hardcore, so it got toned down, but is now back in for your viewing pleasure.
And you can see all these characters. Not at all. I think Squirrely Squirrel is one of my favorite characters.
Yeah. If I could just start another animated show, it'd probably be the Squirrely Squirrel show.
And here's the part here where Kurt Russell and the guys go in, again, ripped off shot for shot.
That's why we just decide, let's just go for it. Let's just have Kurt Russell be the guy.
Yeah. So if he doesn't do anything, he just goes and gets raped.
Yeah.
Goes in and gets raped. And
by a bear.
Dies.
He gets raped by a bear. We should just, in the chapter selections, call this Kurt Russell Raped by a Bear.
There should be three or four chapters just in the scene. Kurt Russell sent in to get raped by the bear. Kurt Russell get raping by a bear. Get raped, and then Kurt Russell got raped.
I always like moments in the show where everyone's just standing around listening to what's going on, like a little later here when they finally go into the portal. It's like in the 24 show we did when he goes into Hillary Clinton's snooze and finds
basically like a radio
a creature in there.
It's like a radio show.
Yeah.
Doing
radio shows.
We used Sector 2 like four times in there, or two times, three times.
Yeah, and it wasn't
funny, stupid lines. It was like, because there's another thing. We spent a long time trying to figure out, all right, well, Cartman's got to break into the Pentagon. So then we had these scenes. We had a couple of them written where it's like he's sneaking outside and, you know, pistol whipping a guard, like all this shit, and then we just said, you know what, none of that matters, just get him in there. And so it was just a stupid thing of like, it really is.
So what writing's all
how
about.
How easy you is it to break up, into the Pentagon? Yeah,
you always end up writing stuff and coming up with stuff, but if it's not totally necessary to the story, you pull it out, because for us, a scene should be important to the scene before it and the scene after it, and unlike some shows I won't mention, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, some shows. That's side shots of Cartman, when he's really small, like the one here in this scene with the nuts.
I just love that he brought nuts.
He brought nuts just for that joke. But side shot, I figured out that side shots of Cartman when Cartman is really small are my favorite shots in shows. Because Cartman is so fucking funny looking. But it's always when he's small, when he's running, when he's side view small. I think they're really funny.
But this interrogation room scene is probably my favorite scene in the entire show, a trilogy of shows, because, you know, there's just so much shit going down right now. And it just all gets quieted down and comes right back to, you know, what it's supposed to be about. And it really comes kind of halfway through the trilogy. It's kind of cool. It's like
it's about halfway through. So Cartman has him, and if he would just lower his pants, Kyle says, "I will suck your balls," but because of his own arrogance, he'll miss it. That doesn't happen to Jack Bauer a lot, but that happens to bad guys a lot in movies.
There's a lot of structural flaws in this trilogy, but that I think we got an A+ for that scene.
Yeah, and the whole ball sucking thing, actually, if you track it out, works pretty well.
Yeah.
Much better than the Imaginationland stuff, actually.
Well, the Imaginationland is so big. So easy when you get two characters that hate each other that want different things.
Yeah. This is all right here, shot for shot. Kissing the cross, going through the little thing. Like six shots. What do we have? Kurt Russell, can and here, you hear then me? Kurt Russell gets raped by Christmas critters. We're somewhere. They are inside the imagination, sir. What do you see in there? There's lots of. Trying to think, what else can we talk about? This is the longest we've ever gone on a commentary.
Yeah, and this is why. I mean, because we've just really. We like talking about this stuff, but there's just not that much we can tell.
I don't think you're supposed to talk straight through like we do. I think people sit in other commentaries and, like, sit and watch a scene and talk about that scene and they're quiet. Right. And I don't. I've never really listened to a commentary, so I don't really know.
We can talk about why I decided to position all these people this certain way in this shot.
You know, the other thing is, I think a lot of times on director's commentaries, it's talking about a live-action thing where they were on set. I mean, there's just a lot more shit to talk about.
And they're kind of remembering it.
Remembering it, and it's like, this guy was sick that day, or this was a tough shoot because of the lighting, or, like, you know, and they have, like, and we're just in an office. We're in the same fucking office all the time.
Yeah.
And so all we can really talk about is the writer's room meetings and the ideas. And
then that was what we lived through.
Yeah.
Was the torture of trying to make it all make sense. But I do like, I like that, you know, it there's when things fall into place, you know, it was suddenly like, oh, wow, Stan's right there to hear this. And he was the one who heard the story of the Christmas critters. He knows who they are. And that was a really nice thing that just happened.
And it gives them all of reason to not want to go in there. That's why no one else goes in there.
Carmen's back to his camera hobby. He really loves photography.
We've kind of established that he's a photographer.
He takes some really nice
pictures. Shot right there with him in his little king hat, side view small, that's my favorite shot in the whole show. And like, that's my favorite shot of the whole season.
Yeah. Got these big battle shots of all of Imaginationland or whatever, but it's just the little king.
That shot's so fucking funny.
I mean, the part of the reason I love scenes like this in South Park is just because I'm still always surprised by how much emotion you can get across with their little round eyes. And I mean, we have nothing to work with. We have eyebrows,
eyes and eyebrows,
and a mouth shape, and that's it. Everyone looks exactly the same. And yet, you know, especially with Carmen and even Kyle in that scene, that there's so many sort of different emotions happening, and you get it.
All you need is eyes and,
Eyebrows and mouth shape does it all.
That's about it.
Their eyes never change, just the eyebrows. And we have words for that. We have, you know, it's always worried eyebrows for when they're the one way, angry eyebrows for the other. And sometimes a shot will just come in and the eyebrows will be kind of neutral and be like, oh, no, that should be worried eyebrows and a number 8 mouth. And because we have all these different mouths and we number them, and a number 8 mouth is one that's kind of slightly open. And so worried eyebrows, number 8 mouth gets you a certain emotion, depending on what's going on. And then, like, neutral eyebrows and a number 4 mouth gets you a completely different emotion. It's really interesting.
It's worked, somehow. That seems like quite a coincidence.
I was just playing with my friends. A lot of this stuff came from, I don't remember when exactly we figured out the whole thing that, because there was, at one point it was going to be
Nine
that.
And stuff?
Yeah, because remember it was going to be that. I mean, we always wanted the thing of, like, that the reveal that Jesus is in there, too. And it kind of fell, I think it kind of, because Jesus is a South Park character, a lot of people took it to mean, oh, okay, well, they're just saying that that's South Park. You know, that's he's part of, South Park's part of Imaginationland, too. And actually what we were trying to say was more getting into those whole themes of that there are these great characters throughout time, that there's the Luke Skywalkers and there's the, you know, like Roman gods, and there's all these the stories that we've grown up with, you know, throughout
Thundercats,
and yep. Jesus is another one of those stories, and you know, just another sort of imaginary character that matters because these stories matter and they teach us things. But anyway, I don't think that all that stuff kind of
it does. I mean, it comes works. Up. What we wanted is that there's no kind of like. I mean, even though Jesus is on the Council of Nine, so is Popeye. So right. It's like, Jesus isn't the most important imaginary character. There's no hierarchy to him. It's like, there's Jesus, there's Count Chocula, right. There's Snarf, there's like Roman guys, there's Tron guys,
so again, it's kind of the same. It's that anti-Christian thing that's like, yeah, to us, Jesus is just another imaginary character. But then there's the sort of anti-atheist thing, you know, which is the whole theme of the people that are ready to just nuke it, basically, and say, let's just get rid of these things because, you know, let's just get rid of Jesus. The world will be a better place without Jesus. And that whole protection of, like, no, these things are important. The whole sort of Kyle speech at the end of this trilogy, you know, that, like, this stuff's important. You can't just, you know, you don't want to nuke Jesus. That's, you know, that matters. Jesus matters. Santa Claus matters. Luke Skywalker matters. I love all that shit.
Of course, going along with our smart show themes of terrorists nuked us in our imagination, and so some people use it as an excuse to say, well, it's religion, we need to get rid of it.
Right.
And so this was our really smart three-part retort to that.
Super smart with lots of ball sucking.
Then we put ball sucking in so we won't get any awards. It took us that long to do it. But the Council of Nine, this was kind of a late call, too, that there would be a Council of Nine, I think.
Yeah.
We figured that out kind of later. This scene here with Kyle dead is, of course, ripped off completely, almost shot for shot, from The Abyss, starring Ed Harris was the guy who was Cartman?
Yeah. Ed Harris was Cartman. Ed Harris wanted the balls in that movie.
Yeah. But his girlfriend was, or wife was dying. So he had, this was from that end part of The Abyss.
Well, at least now he doesn't have to suck anyone.
And this also happens a lot of time, and Jack Bauer has to save the guy's life.
Yeah.
Or kill himself, or save his own life. Or some permutation of it. This is good timing, right? At the end of the episode. Now he's not going to get his ball sucked. And of course, that's what you're most invested in right now, as the viewer.
Right, but again, you can't go, in the old days, you would go out on, but he's dead, I'm not going to get my ball sucked. And you'd go out on that, right? But you had to, now in the new way that people write, it's that he actually brings him back, and now I'm gonna get my balls sucked. Here we go. See it next week. You know, that's the new way. That's the lost way to write, which is cool. I like it. I had fun writing this stuff because it was just, you know, a different way to think about stuff. I don't want to do it again. I don't think I want to do another trilogy. But
so fun, we'll never do it again.
Probably be it.
Breathe easy. He's okay. He can still suck my balls. Let's get him some lemons and some chapstick right away.
I believe this child was brought to.
Have anything else we want to talk about this?
Well, we're almost to the end of episode two.
That's pretty good for
and
us.
And that's that if we were to take back control, you know, because then I don't really remember. Definitely episode three was the hardest.
Mm-hmm.
Episode one, you were able to just sort of throw everything up in the air. Didn't you know? You had a lot of choices of where you were going to go out on things.
Episode two was the most fun, I think.
Episode two was the most fun because really on Thursday we didn't know where we were going, but by the end of the day Thursday we had all kind of beat out. We kind of knew where it should go.
Because you didn't have to figure everything out. You just had to keep the balls up in the air in a fun way, and you didn't have to really like close any stories or bring any big conclusion or pay off three episodes worth of shit.
And then we got to episode three and we're like, oh fuck, now we gotta wrap everything up. And it was a lot more like a typical South Park episode where we kind of, you know, Friday had a few scenes, Saturday had a few more, you know, just slowly worked our way into the point where we finally had a structure by Tuesday morning, basically.
Man, yeah, I remember this. But we did have an end.
We really liked the end of the hospital, you know, the wake up, Kyle. Hello, Kyle, with the crown. I really like that. I just like that every, you know, we obviously like the meta joke that it's like, we're doing this trilogy, we're doing this big grand thing, and it's all about ball sucking, really. And of course it's not. If it was really all about ball sucking, I don't think anyone would have.
No, but
really,
I mean, when we started talking about it, I think we had much more politics in it and much more kind of theme and terrorism and government and shit. And I'm so, I mean, now you watch it now and I think there's just the right amount, which isn't a lot.
Right.
Because that's just boring to watch. But ball sucking is evergreen. It always is good.
Yeah.
It's always there for you. We always do that. We've done that with a lot of shows. We did it with Team America, where the first drafts start out very kind of on point thematically, and then we have to go back and strip all that shit out of it and put something like ball sucking in.
Yeah.
To make it funny.
But so, you know, having to sort of, and again, you know, you're at a thing where you're like, okay, all the good characters in Imaginationland against all the bad ones. Have fun, animators. You know, and you've got 5 days to do it. You sort of pick your battles, basically. You decide. And again, you know, it's not like in a show like South Park we're ever going to get to the point where everyone's like, that show is awesome because those shots were so cool. You know, it's like there's obviously way better animation out there than us. And we know our job is more to do ball sucking, basically. So we spent more time with that. We kind of knew for a long time we were going to involve Al Gore in this whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, there was a whole way it went where Al Gore was going to, you know, he was more about the, our imagination is dying. And we had actually a whole scene. Remember, we had whole scene animated where...
He came and gave a presentation. Our imaginations are dying. And the joke being that, like, look what's happening. Like, Broadway shows turned into movies, turned back into Broadway shows.
Yeah.
It was like the whole thing. And then it was like... The only thing that's come out is sequels. It was like, because last summer was all, just everything was a sequel. But then we decided that made it sound like old fuddy-duddies.
Yeah, and you can see it wasn't that funny, so then we cut it. Gotta be careful. Make sure you cut what's not funny.
Sometimes we do that. Well, anything else? How many minutes have we made?
Well, if you've made it this far, you're... Yeah. You're real troopers.
You're a better man than
we
me.
We really appreciate it. We're basically, as we do this, we're about 3 weeks away from starting our next run of South Park, and we have some pretty good. We actually have some pretty good ideas to start with this time.
I think so. I don't think we have this kind of great.
We don't have
the Sunday kind of good
Sunday.
We don't
have Sunday ball
with
sucking.
Nuts.
What was the one we were gonna add? A salad. Wouldn't
balsamic.
You like a side salad with some balsamic dressing?
Yeah, balsamic vinegar. Maybe we should add it.
Maybe we'll put it in. Actually, as we do this, we still have a couple days before we have to deliver this DVD, so maybe we'll put it in somewhere. But
that's it for now. That's the longest commentary we've ever done, I think.
And hope you liked it and love you.
Bye-bye.
What's happened? Well, let's see.